Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. Well, folks, welcome again to this show, because in all due respect, we've got to deal with an issue that comes around on an annual, on a yearly basis. We're talking about right in a 2 months period. We've talked about Dr. King's birthday, you know, and one of two birthdays that was pretty well celebrated and identified in this country, when George Washington was one of them, and then Dr. King, and we've gone through that piece. We've always done that. And then the second month would be February, the month of February, we got Black History Month. And also during that particular time also too, there's President Lincoln's birthday, and we're celebrating that also too. And you know, and so what we wanted to do this time around, rather than the non-traditional situation of just either dealing with one entity at a time, we're gonna basically talk to those that time frame from an Oregon perspective. And so what we're going to do the first half hour is that we're going to get one of our own here in Oregon, a very well-respected individual who happens to be a man of the cloth, but prior to that was in business, and I mean just across the board. It was hard to find a person of his caliber, but I'm talking about Matt Hennessy, first the businessman, but Matt Hennessy, the servant, if you will, who pastors Vancouver Avenue Baptist Church. And a very progressive, very, just a part of the community, a part of Oregon. And so what we're going to do, we're going to give the servant Matt Hennessy the opportunity, the pastor Matt Hennessy, for those of him in the community and whatever, he will hopefully share with us and you and the public and whatever, his message, if you will, during the King celebration at Vancouver Avenue Baptist Church. He's going to share that with us, and then we'll just go from there. And then the second half hour, we're going to probably take some calls on and sort of like bring in folks out there in from the viewing audience standpoint, if they got something on their mind in regards to what does this time period represents to them during that particular time from an Oregon perspective. Okay, let's keep it from that way. Matt, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Bruce. It's great to be with you again. And to be with your viewing audience.
Good. Well, I tell you what, you're a blessing today, my friend. You've done a lot. I know you've done a lot. And I'd like to have you on here every day.
You're kind. That is very kind.
Well, Matt, first off, why don't you just share with the viewing audience a little bit about your background and bring that up to date. And then let's talk about Dr. King.
No, I appreciate that, Bruce. Remember, I was born to a teenage mother who was born to a teenage mother. I lived in two foster homes, two orphan homes back in Ohio, and at 17, I was out on my own. And I learned a lot from the School of Hard Knocks, dealt with a lot of issues, but was somehow determined to keep on fighting, keep on moving, and try to make something of myself. I was, I have to tell you, very inspired by the life of Dr. King. Mm-hmm. Felt very much that the dream that he had, that I felt I was a part of that, and that there was nothing that I should allow to get in my way of being a success. And at the same time, I was a child of God. So I started a relationship with the Lord many years ago when I was 9 years old. But then I also started preaching when I was my first sermon was about Dr. King's dream when I was 9 years old. Thank God I've come a long way from
there. Where were you then? Where were you living?
I was still in Columbus, Ohio.
Still in Columbus, okay.
And then, had the blessing of being able to go to college, one of the only kids from the orphan home who could that year, and then went from there into city government, where I spent the next 12 years as city manager or assistant city manager, and also working as the civilian head of police and fire. Worked with several unions in terms of union negotiations, grievances, things of that nature. Then came to Oregon. I was in Ohio and Michigan, and then came to Oregon in 1988 to help the workers' compensation system here and lead the transformation, really, of the workers' compensation system in Oregon, and then went on to Nike for the next 8.5, almost 9 years as a leader in international business, both, I should say, both here in the States as well as in Europe, Asia, and South America. Mm-hmm. And then went on to lead a company, a private company, as the CEO for the next 7.5 years. Mm-hmm. Again, doing business in the United States, Canada, mm-hmm. In the UK, France, and Germany. And then God called me into pastorship.
Wow.
And believe me, I tried to run away from it. I really tried not to do that. Mm-hmm. But it really is where my calling was. Mm-hmm. And I feel blessed, really, just celebrating my 9th year as the pastor of Vancouver Avenue First Baptist Church.
Time passes, man.
Well, you know, it's 9 years, as far as you know, as a pastor. Right. It's dog years,
yes.
So it's really more like 63 years as pastor. But it's a great church, great group of people. We've been really blessed, and I feel really honored to have served in the way I have, to have really, you know, been really a life of being in the public sector, mm-hmm. in the private sector.
Right.
And as you well know, I served as PDC chair
for
a couple of years, mm-hmm. and served on the board for 3 years. So God's really given me a really rounded perspective of a lot of what goes on in life.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, again, thinking about Dr. King's day and thinking about those 9 years that you were there with
yes.
the congregation or whatever, I'm sure they were always looking for a message. And knowing Matt, as I've known Matt, is that it's not just a commercial message.
Yeah.
It was one that was relating to the congregation and recognizing all of the issues and ills,
yes.
if you will, that the congregation is going through on a day-to-day basis. I'm sure you, again, this 9-year aspect of it, can you kind of talk to, I'm sure you've had the opportunity when you first got in, you had your first match of that first year, and then I'm sure you saw things grow,
right?
And you saw your congregation. Take us through that and bring us up to date.
No, I appreciate that, Bruce. You know, it's really interesting because in the Northwest, it's a very interesting place to pastor. Mm-hmm. The least churched region of the entire nation is this region. Mm-hmm. So one of the things we know is it's going to be hard to attract people to come to church because people are very independent minded mm-hmm. here. But what I've learned is this, on the one hand, we must keep at it because the fact of the matter is the message of God is that strong. Secondly, when it relates to the King family in particular, you know that I was a godson of Coretta Scott King for 20 years wow. before her passing. And so I got the opportunity to really be up close personal in her house, at church. The two of us had one of those kind of relationships. I don't care whether it was birthday, Christmas, whatever. Mrs. King, Mom Coretta, I called her at the time, mm-hmm. was really just somebody I could depend on. Mm-hmm. The message of Dr. King, in my view, has always been compelling. A message that literally, if we take it to, you know, the religious aspect, Martin Luther's issue with the church was that he tacked 95 theses on the door at the Church of Wittenberg because he said, I can't find these 95 things in the Bible.
Hmm.
Martin Luther King's message was really the same. You know what? We've got the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. I can't find anywhere in the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution that says it's okay for people to be treated in the way that black people in America are being treated. And again, he really spoke to the soul of the United States of America, and that message was captured all over the world. And if you think about it, Martin Luther King made it clear the victory of now as we call African American people was not won just by African American people. It was won because labor came to the table, mm-hmm. whites came to the table, labor came to the table, you know, you name it, every a picture of a person from the rainbow came to the table to say, as Dr. King said, all men can't be free. I'm sorry, no man is free or woman is free until all men and women are free. So the message this year is I, you know, over the years have always called it living the dream. This year we were redeeming the dream.
Redeeming.
We saluted greatness on Saturday to provide an opportunity, and I'll make sure to get you a copy of the programs, to really say there's some drum majors, there's some people doing great work here in Portland, and we were really, really blessed to salute them. Duncan Campbell at Friends of the Children, mm-hmm. Tony Arnerich, who's done a marvelous job with work in Irvington School, to St. Vincent de Paul, who's done a great job with a mobile kitchen in the rural areas of Oregon, and Anthony Jordan, who's done a marvelous job in sports, but also helping kids, equipping them to go to college. The message this year was different than any other year we've had, because I said, I'm tired of, not tired, that's not fair, but yeah, maybe it's right.
Yeah.
My point was, let's not just come and hear great speeches, let's go do something as well. So we had a call to action in our Sunday program. And the push for the call to action was to say, let's not just come and talk about Dr. King's dream. Let's not just come and talk about the wonderful things that he did and all the progress that we've made. But why don't we say we're asking people to come together as a community to help us do something. And I didn't want a laundry list. I wanted one thing that we could hone in on. And one of the things that we decided to hone in on was the issue of hunger. We said, you know what? It's a shame for a state that's as agricultural as ours is to have so many hungry people. And we are one of the hungriest states in the nation. So we made a decision. We're all going to work with Oregon Food Bank. We found out that rather than giving them cans of food and dry food, that what we can do is give them money, and literally $10 a month translates into 30 meals. $25 a month translates into 75 meals. I made a pledge myself and started it the other day and asked, there were 75 people who pledged as well. They're going to do likewise. Some other, whether it's volunteer, give money, whatever. We want to make sure that Oregon, we reduce the amount of hunger in this region. That's what we're after. We had a great speech. Dr. Bethel did a great job as a speaker. But Margaret Carter, Senator Margaret Carter, led a panel discussion, and the discussion was, let's focus on hunger. Let's get together as a community and do some things that are going to be really good about really reducing the amount of hungry people in this region. What we are doing then is in August, we're going to come together as a community and find out how much all of us have done to reduce hunger. And then we're going to come together again in January of next year and say, here's what the report card is. You really hit my, so if I sound really passionate, preach,
it's good.
It really is the fact that we need to quit just talking about things that we need to do and really do something. And that's really what we chose this year to do.
You know, a point you made in regards to hunger from a historical standpoint, I know of a person who basically, as far as I'm concerned, initiated the whole issue of actually outreaching and getting the food. It just happened to have been at Bethel AME Church.
Oh, is that right? Wow.
Clara Peoples.
Is that right?
That's
yes,
right.
I know
Clara
her name,
Peoples.
Yes.
And Clara was the one that was putting food in her car, going out to the farmers and this, that, and the other. And but in all due respect, it really has not been recognized along that line. The food bank really was originated by Clara Peoples.
Well, then we're going to have to do something
you know
about that. Yes.
And at one point in time, we had approached the organization and suggested that maybe on Marine Drive, they've got a food bank over there. Wouldn't it be neat to just maybe list it as just a dedication of some sort? People's Bank.
Very good.
And it makes sense. Well, Clara Peoples, you know, she's well known.
I promise you I'm going to do my part to help.
Please.
And
as you know, the Juneteenth thing is something else that she's always identified with.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, she's done so much. But I throw that out because.
Thank you.
So in Oregon, we were doing some things.
Yeah.
And she was a person of color.
Isn't that sweet?
You know, and she was feeding everybody. She wasn't just feeding black folks.
Amen.
She was feeding everybody over the state.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can go to her house. I mean, she's bringing all over the place. So I want to make sure
I appreciate that
particular point.
Yeah.
What other areas that you feel that your message to you, again, to the congregation you were giving out?
Well, I appreciate that because one of the things we wanted to do this year, and we actually, you know, education's a big deal to me.
Yes.
Huge. So I talk about education. I'll also come back to crime, to juvenile justice and crime. But education's big because I still believe it's the way out. I know as a person who grew up as I did, you know, the fact that I was actually able to go to school and graduate, and then in my later years, even as pastor, go back and earn my Master's of Divinity, and now I'm finishing a doctorate at George Fox Seminary. Education is really where it's at. We give the whole weekend, which, by the way, is my 9th anniversary weekend or whatever, my pastoral anniversary weekend. We are, whatever money we raise, after all our bills are paid, we give to the scholarship fund because I want every young person possible to be able to have a chance to do something productive in their lives, whether it's go to whether it's a community college, 4-year institution, go to a trade school, mm-hmm. or earn a trade through the unions, something like that, or to go to do military service, whatever it is, or just get a job. I want our kids to grow up and do something productive, not hang out on the streets, not get involved in crime that will literally mess them up for the rest of their lives, but really to say, we want you to do constructive things with your life. That's a theme that really we have continued since the very first time we had the drum major service. This year we did something different. We actually adopted 4 schools, Helen's View High School, Roosevelt High School, De La Salle North Catholic, and Jefferson. And we asked each one of those schools to, in their own way, each one of those principals, in their own way, determine how to select a young person who is either a junior or a senior at their school, mm-hmm. whose students, faculty, and administrators could look at as embodying the spirit of Dr. King, Mrs. King, Rosa Parks, mm-hmm. and Yolanda King, and we named it as a Student Humanitarian Award. 4 young people were selected. Each one of them got a $500 scholarship from us, because that's really what it's all about. So education's one big deal.
Very much so.
The other one is still the issue of wanting to make sure that our children understand the importance of doing things productively, staying out of trouble. Mm-hmm. I mentioned to you when I was on your show a couple years ago how we started a process where we're walking in the park voluntarily. All I can tell you is, with the support of the Portland Police Department, the Multnomah County Sheriff, the TriMet Police, the Doubletree Security, and Lloyd Center Security, we've been walking in the park since April of 2011. So this April, it'll be 3 years. We have, because of all of everybody's help, I should say, we have been able to reduce crime in that park by 47%.
Wow.
That's just how great that is. What did we do? We didn't wait to develop a strategic plan. We didn't go to the Portland police to say, help us. We just said, we're going out there to work, and we're going to walk around this park. And people like Commander Modica has said, if you show up, that is one of the biggest deterrents to crime.
Well, they're all family members.
There you go.
Families, you know,
there you go.
That's a congregation. Those
that's right.
Grandkids.
You got it.
And the like. And in fact,
that's
that,
right.
You know, get them back to the table.
That's
so
right.
To speak.
That's Matt, exactly.
Fact, on that particular note, what do we do about the family today? The family, the whole concept of family has changed so much, and people are struggling. They want to be family.
Yeah.
But there's so many situations out there, and I'm just being very honest about this deal. There's a whole issue about, and you know, as you know, from an African American perspective, we are very family oriented.
Oh yes, very much.
Even
so.
To this day.
That's right.
And I know there was this issue about, in all due respect, the gay situation and whatever. That's happening right now. I mean, we need to talk about it.
That's right.
Because that to me, in many ways, at my age factor, I'm a very family oriented kind of a guy, and I'm saying from a futuristic standpoint, you have to have family.
That's right.
To develop the right makeup, if you will. Mm-hmm. What are you hearing from the congregation? What's your feel about? What can you give us?
Well, you know, we are, you know, it's interesting to look at our congregation, which on the one hand is a traditional African American church,
right.
With a number of people now who are not African American, right. Who are members.
Yes.
And therefore there is a culture among African Americans that we're all family anyway.
Right.
Exactly. Doesn't matter what the color of our skin
right.
is,
that's
doesn't
right.
matter where we've grown up
that's
or
right.
anything like
that's
that,
right.
we're all family.
Yes, right.
So at our church, we on third Sunday have a place for kids to go to youth church, and we're starting now a nursery mm-hmm. for young people. But what I've always found interesting in our church is that if you bring a baby into church, you can expect that somebody else is going to help you, you know, care for your baby during service.
Wow.
What it's not unusual for somebody just to say, you know what, you go ahead and enjoy the service, I'm going to take care of your baby. That
wow.
just happens.
Really?
Or I've said to every child that comes that is a member of our church, to their parents, you know, I adopt all these kids, they all belong mm-hmm. to me, right? Mm-hmm. They're your children,
yeah.
but they belong to me. The church is still one of the most important foundations in the life of a young person growing up.
Mm-hmm.
to be able to be in church and know that you can be corrected by somebody who loves you that may not be your biological mother or father, mm-hmm. or to recognize that somebody cares enough to want to do something for you, whatever that may be. Mm-hmm. And in some cases, it may be that you've got a mother who's struggling and not able to buy her children shoes or to buy them a new, you know, set of clothes or something mm-hmm. like that. And somebody else who will volunteer quietly mm-hmm. and put the money in the mother's hand to say, baby, don't you worry about it. You go ahead and take care of your child. That is still one of the core of not just our church, but I believe almost every church across the country, across the world, who particularly have that culture and understanding that family matters. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, however, our church, like many, we still have too many homes that are headed by females alone. Mm-hmm. And we have too many situations where particularly young boys and young girls are growing up without the influence of a male. And I mean a positive influence of a male. And, you know, one of the things that we try to do is make sure a guy at our church, John Frazier Sr., just said, you know what, I'm taking all these guys, right? Every young man in the church has an opportunity to be a man of Timothy, who literally works with him. He goes not just teaching them manners, not just teaching them how to go to school and do well. And if they don't do well in school, he's at the school. Mm-hmm. He will go there and meet with their teachers and meet with their parents and do what he can to make sure that they get better. But one of the things I was challenged with the other day, which I do look forward to doing, is helping our young men understand how to treat young women, to help them understand how to be polite, to help them understand how they're supposed to talk with them, to help them understand how they're supposed to be, quote, manly with them and not do negative things and be involved in negative behavior and things of that nature. Family's still very, very important, Bruce. Yeah. We've got a long way to go. There are a lot of things, I think, that are happening, again, not just in our church, but in community and in many churches around. Mm-hmm. But the one thing I believe is that we aren't losing. We're not going to lose every young black male. Mm-hmm. We're determined we're going to put our arms around him and do everything that we can to work with them, pray with them, and teach them.
You know, I really appreciate, in fact, even your background from a standpoint of focusing on the education piece, very, very important. And as you know, in our town here in the state of Oregon, more specifically in the largest metropolitan area in the state of Oregon, which is Portland, Oregon, the Multnomah County aspect of it, we're still struggling from the standpoint of giving young people tools, if you will, to be more assertive in the education system. Because when I came up, we had voc ed.
Yes,
we
that's
had
right.
Kid.
Right.
Whether it be carpentry, metalworks, or this, that, and the other. But that was a reference piece, if you will, to be able to be enthusiastic about reading, writing, and arithmetic.
That's right.
We don't have that in the school today.
That's right.
Are you getting, are folks reaching out to you in terms of what can we do about this situation?
Well, I think that there are some great things that can be done already. I mean, we live in a community with a community college across from Jefferson High School. We've got the Skills Center, which I think, the Margaret Carter Skills Center, which I think is extremely important. We've got great work being done by places like SCI, who are doing a wonderful job both teaching young people, being a charter school to them, and also giving after-school programs and things of that nature. We've got work being done at schools like Irvington School, which I mentioned early on by Tony Arnerich and the group there. I think that's all good. What I would like to see, and truly what I'm praying and hoping for, is that much like Duncan Campbell's model, where he has, you know, every young person has a mentor, and that mentor stays with them through junior high and high school and all, and, you know, and potentially through life, is that I would love to see business get together with churches, the faith community, and really us ask each other, what can we do to put our arms around young people that are growing up today? There are things that we can do from a standpoint of how we teach them culturally, help them understand the importance of how to survive, and how businesses can come alongside from a standpoint I know what I'm thinking about. It's like having internships and things of that nature to really help the young people be able to put what they learn from us into action in the workplace. I believe it's very, very important. And I believe that in too many cases, young people have wrong models and wrong understandings of how they are supposed to interface in the workplace, and therefore they don't develop, much like you and I did when we were growing up, the kind of work ethic, you know. So you're sick when you wake up today, so you don't feel the best when you wake up, you still must go to work because you have a responsibility to be there, and that you don't look to everybody else to take care of you, that you look to yourself and say, I've got to be responsible. I've had a job, Bruce, ever since I was 9 years old. And the truth of the matter is we're growing up too many, and by the way, I'm as responsible as anybody else for spoiling the generation after me, because I've got a son, 27. I know I spoiled him, his wife, his three children, and the whole bit, my grandchildren. But the fact is we must teach responsibility, and we must understand the importance of community and generations later to give them an inheritance and to work with them to be responsible and accountable people.
Another point, going back to Dr. King, and knowing, as you say, when you look at the history and his progression, he was very progressive
at
that particular time. And I think some folks missed the boat to a certain degree, because had he lived, I think we wouldn't be sitting here discussing about the whole issue of race, you know, racism and bigotry and this, that, and the other, not as much as. You always going to have that 1% or 10% anyway.
Right.
But the what I'd like for you to respond to is that this whole issue of commercial, because Oregonians are struggling in this way. You hear things like you've got more whites here, and it's and people of color are struggling, if you will, trying to be a part of if your inclusion. What do you say to Oregonians out there who are, let's say, in the, say, a majority aspect of it? And all due respect, I'll throw this piece on it. I'm sort of reminded in the Black History Month, I think it was Morgan Freeman was being interviewed by Mike Wallace. Remember that one? Where Mike Wallace had basically said, what about Black history? And Morgan Freeman got off and said, wait a minute, I'm not into Black history, okay? And then he goes to Mike and says, well, look, you like, what about white history? Oh, would you be called white history? He said, no, I'm not interested in being called white history. Well, what would you be called? Well, he said, I'm Jewish. This is Mike Wallace.
Right.
Well, Mike, what about Wallace. Jewish history? He said, no, I don't want to be called Jewish history.
Right.
But there was a point that was being made there. And that was a very key point. And I'm just throwing that out to say that now we're here in Oregon, and that same conversation is happening here and there.
Yeah.
What do you say to Oregonians about the benefit, if you will, of inclusion for all Americans?
Well, I appreciate it. I was just at Corbin University in Salem on this past Monday. Mm-hmm. I've been blessed to be there to speak at that university for the last 6 years straight. It's a majority white campus.
Right.
And my message to them, as I would say, my message would be to all of Oregon, particularly majority of Oregon, because I've got good friends who will say to me, well, why do we need Black history? Yeah. Why do we still need to do that? I don't really like the idea of a month just for Black history. But part of the reason why it's important is because it really shares something that people don't know anything about. And what we've found, whether it's in Oregon or anywhere else, if people aren't a part of it, they don't know anything about it, they will not try to go get the information on their own, and therefore you've got to provide the information for them. Oregon is a great state. We've got really great history. We've got the same kind of schizophrenic history as it relates to race as anybody else does. But when my message, my small message to the people of Oregon would be, continue to remember, just like I've asked people when it comes to doing work on the South waterfront, I said, why is it we don't get as many, quote, minorities in jobs? Mm-hmm. We don't, because you don't want them there. Mm-hmm. And what we've got to do is put your arms around people that don't look like you and give them the same opportunity you would either give your own child or your own family member, or give them the opportunity that you would want them to get. Mm-hmm. Our job is to not worry about color. I've worked in this state for 25 years, and I have always been generally the first Black or the only Black that has ever been in the positions I've been in with a majority white workforce, and yet we work together, we get things done together, and we open our mouths and our minds to really recognize we're all in this for the same reasons. Mm-hmm. We want good business and good work done, and the average parent wants for their children what I want for mine. Mm-hmm. The average person who lives in a neighborhood wants the same thing that I want and that you want, and that's to live safe in our neighborhoods, to be able to go to our stores without problems. But we cannot allow people to think that you can shut your eyes to what is not good and do nothing about it and wait on somebody else to take care of it when you recognize we need together to work on whatever those problems are.
You know, another question I'll ask, and we're going to take about an extra 2 minutes or so before we break, if you will. But what comes to mind also, too, here in Oregon, I think when you start thinking about this culture and aspect of it, there was a concern, if you will, during the time that A.V.L. Gordley was there, Margaret Carter was there, and Jackie Winters.
Yes.
And I think it was in the 90s, I guess. And they pushed it through the legislature to put that culture into the classroom.
Cultural competency,
but guess what? It's never been enforced.
Right.
It's never been enforced. It's just been sitting there. That would that not have helped, if you will, this whole issue? It should be American history, Oregon history. For that
I believe day. It. You know I saying? Do. I do.
And this is something that hopefully we can work on. I'm gonna throw that on your plate too, if you don't mind.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
Because we need, if you will, leadership to transition that in.
We do.
You got me.
We do.
Because otherwise, it's still the black and the white situation. It's America.
That's right.
And that's where it's all about. And then you're still gonna have to those folks who are sitting here waiting for those dates. Whether they be on the commercial aspect of it, they want to be somebody. They are somebody.
That's right.
And they need to be helped, if you will, to transition in the whole deal on both sides of the aisle, for that matter.
I agree.
Okay. So, well, look, this has been great.
I enjoy it.
What we're going to do, we're going to go on and we're going to take some calls. I can't say what kind of calls we're going to get, but I'm asking the viewing audience to share what does Black History Month mean to them, Dr. King or whether it be Lincoln, I'm talking about the entire community can call. But please, I mean, we're diverse or whatever, however you feel, please give us a call. Because what we're Oregonians, we're Americans, and we're just trying to say, hey, that this next maybe this next Black History Month will only be an Oregon History Month.
Yeah.
And we'll have a parade or something.
Well, that's all right.
I'll put that on your plate, too.
Oh, good grief. Oh, my gosh. My plate's going to be real full when I leave here today.
Put that on your plate.
Yeah.
Okay. We're going to take a short break, folks, and then we're going to come back and take your calls. Please do us give a call.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
No, I appreciate it.
Well, welcome back, folks. Again, I'm Bruce Broussard, your host here at the Oregon Voters Digest, and our guest today is a renowned servant of Vancouver Avenue Baptist Church, the Honorable Mr. Matt Hennessy.
Thank you, Bruce.
Appreciate that.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
I want to thank you for that first 30 minutes that we've met, and hopefully Oregonians will have appreciated some of the points that we're making, and take action, and that's the key. Take action. We, as you know, we've got an upcoming election coming on right now, and I would suggest very strongly that you read those voters' pamphlets and you get people to talk to you, get the news. It's not just, quote, the puff, if you will, on the ads routine, because those are pretty well organized by others from the money aspect of it. This is a very important race during the particular time, so we can go to the next tier.
Mm-hmm.
This is very important. Very important. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're just going to go on and take some calls here now. It's my understanding we've got someone on the line. And we'd like for them to go on and respond. And like I said, just go on and respond to whatever's on your mind in regards to the, let's say, the timing, right? The time frame. Dr. King, or if not that, Black History Month, what does it mean to you? And then we've got Lincoln, President Lincoln, who's also part of that too. Many folks are having activities along that line. Okay, you got a caller? Is there a caller?
Yes, hi, Bruce.
Yes, hi there. Turn it up a little bit, will you? And someone needs to close the studio door here. Somebody left that door open. Okay, good. Sorry about that. Yes, sir, how you doing?
Hey, Bruce, this is Jeff Reynolds calling in.
How you doing, Jeff? How you doing, Jeff?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good. I take it you have just a little response in regards to this time frame we're into right now. I understand you're putting together the Lincoln Day dinner, and I know you're putting that piece together. And also, I guess there were some issues that might have come up during that particular time, and about the auctioning off of a weapon. If you're all right, got me?
Yeah. So I'm happy to come on and kind of explain things and talk about our event. And like you said, we are having our Lincoln Day dinner on February 15th. We are welcoming in Rafael Cruz, who's the father of Senator Ted Cruz of Texas. Rafael has got a very compelling story about escaping from tyranny and oppression and fighting for personal liberty. So he's a dynamic speaker. We're very excited about the event. It is going on despite the hiccup that we experienced this past week. And in conjunction with that, we thought we would do the raffle like we did last year. We had two raffles last year, and so that was part of it, is to do the best we can with fundraising so that we can be successful this year in elections in Oregon and fund our candidates and fund our operation. So that's where we're coming from on that.
Okay. Well, now, the issue, I guess, was the whole issue with the inclusion of Dr. King and also President Lincoln in that same marketing piece. How do you respond to that?
Well, and I understand that caused some tough feelings, and I do apologize for that. That wasn't our intention. Our intention was really just to celebrate two solid Republicans and to talk about the freedoms that they fought for. That was the entire intention. It's all about, you know, for us, celebrating the Constitution, standing up for the Second Amendment, and let's remember too that the Second Amendment, throughout the history of the Republican Party, we're very proud of our civil rights legacy, and we want to showcase that. Mm-hmm. So, our legacy is, you know, we were founded as a Republican Party. We were founded as an abolitionist party, and the Whigs had fallen apart because they weren't taking a strong enough stance on that issue. Mm-hmm. So that's the first thing, and we wanted to celebrate Abraham Lincoln, and we wanted to celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King as another solid conservative who fought for civil rights, and we wanted to honor those legacies. Now, if our raffle got in the way of that and marred those issues, then I'm truly sorry. But the intention was to celebrate the lives and the legacies of these two great men.
Okay. Well, Jeff, thank you very much. I appreciate that. I might add too it was kind of interesting that the idea that Dr. King was associated with Lincoln in the same vernacular. I mean, that's good. That's progression. You know, it's inclusiveness.
Yeah.
You know?
I see it as a great thing. On the one hand, you know, people like to fly spec people's lives.
Right.
People did that to Dr. King's life.
Mm-hmm.
I still say that no matter what, it was President Lincoln who was at the helm, mm-hmm, at the time and signed the Emancipation Proclamation. Nobody can take that away from him. That's what he did. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of historians and others who will say, well, he did it for this reason, he did it for that reason. There was still slave ownership in the border states and things of that nature. He signed the document. That was important. He lost his life, mm-hmm, as a result of his stance when it came to freedoms for people who were slaves.
Mm-hmm.
Very important. Mm-hmm. Dr. King, my belief is, would certainly saw Abraham Lincoln in a very positive light and recognize what he did for the good of the country. And so when those kind of things get marred or people want to take away and say he shouldn't be a part of that, I guess my feeling is look at the larger picture, mm-hmm, and keep focus there. Because what Dr. King knew, what I know in my own life, you the same, Everybody who helped me didn't look like me.
Yeah.
The fact of the matter is, people of all walks of life have been helpful. I'm sure in your life, I know in my life, and I can assure you in Dr. King's life, having lived, really spent time with Mrs. King and understood that. Yeah. The other thing I think this calls to question is people's concern about whether it's the right to bear arms or anything else, and that is, Dr. King was a man of nonviolence. There's no question about that. But also, he's a man who understood the importance of free speech. And everybody must remember that free speech means that even if somebody makes a speech I don't like, it's still their opportunity in this democracy to be able to do that. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jeff. Is he still there? Okay, fine. He's not there. We got another caller. Okay, we got another caller. Caller, you're on the air. Your question or comment, please.
Hello, Bruce. Hello, Pastor Hennessy.
Hello there. How are you?
And that's Fred,
very
right?
Very good show.
Hi, Fred.
Hey, I know Jeff Reynolds listening to this.
Okay.
Hey, Jeff. We got two older black men who are very nice to you, but the majority of black people in Oregon know what you are and know what you did and why you did what you did. So don't take this back to your racist leadership at the Multnomah County Republicans and think you've gotten one over on us. Associating a firearm next to the most important individual in the last 200 years, a man who would not allow his own security guards to carry a firearm because he knew what a using a firearm in a nonviolent movement would do to his movement. He loved this country. He loved humanity so much. He was willing to put his own life and the people around him. And you know that was important to him. On the line by walking into danger unarmed. Any white person who feels it is appropriate to associate a firearm to Dr. Martin Luther King's name, you are not an American. You're not a good person. And I'm never going to forgive you for it. I'm not even going to forgive your wife or your kids. This is permanent. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, then. Wait a minute. Put it back on. Put it back. Well, no, you can't do that. You gotta do that. Okay. All right. Okay. Okay, Fred. Okay. All right. Tell him to cut it. Okay. Okay. Tell him. Tell him. Well, tell him. Okay. Thank you very much, Fred. We appreciate the call, and thank you very much. Okay, I understand we got another caller on the air. Okay, caller, you're on the air. Your question or comment, please.
Hello, Pastor Hennessy.
Hi there.
One of the things I want to say is that I understand.
Is this Mr. Dunham? Mr. Dednam?
Yes, I've been known that. Yes.
How you doing? How you doing, Mr. Dednam?
I'm doing well. I understand Fred's deep, deep passion on this issue. And,
yes.
And I just want everybody to understand this does cut deep. And as you know, both you gentlemen know that I've been a Republican, a lifelong Republican. My daddy was a Republican. This, from a Republican point of view, it is time that I hear the Second Amendment right. And then that day, what you should do on Armistice Day or find a special day to do the Second Amendment. On these days, you should be talking about the 14th and 13th Amendment. That's what you should be celebrating. And even though I don't know Jeff very well, but there's a segment in the Republican Party that's been running around doing this ever since Joe Lutz and those guys did it years and years ago with Lon Mabon, all those evangelicals who did not do the very thing that Pastor Hennessy was talking about, loving each other, mm-hmm. embracing one another.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And so my mm-hmm. message to Jeff, and my message to Jeff is, we are all Americans here.
Mm-hmm.
And if something offends me, they say, cut your arm off. Cut your arm off away from armors when it comes to this sort of thing, because those of us who've been trying to bring folks together, I've received so many negative calls from people saying, see what your Republicans are doing again. Yeah. And I'm just saying, look, even Rance Priebus has been saying, let's moderate, let's make sure we're communicating, that because so much of symbolism to us means quite a bit. You know, that's a heck of a symbol. And so from my perspective, I think that we should make sure that that some sensitivity training goes toward Multnomah County. I think we should be more involved, because I kind of stepped away, Pastor Hennessy and Bruce, and actually I regret that I my feelings were hurt. But we have to be involved.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that makes sense at all. And because if I'm sounding emotional, I am, because I know this country is based upon the greatness of people working together.
Right.
That's what makes a great nation. And frankly, I'm concerned about what the future is, because when there's hard economic times, it's very easy for people to start objectifying folks. If you objectify somebody, it becomes very easy to take that next step. Let's eliminate them. And I think there's a place called Auschwitz.
Okay.
Once people were objectified, then they lost their ability to survive. And so that's where I'm coming from. Okay. And I just hope that that's taken in stride and we can go about trying to make some things happen. Because once again, King said this word, where do we go, from chaos or community?
That's right.
And one of the things I want to do is go toward community. And that includes Jeff, by the way.
That's mm-hmm. right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Okay. So thank you for listening to me today, and I hope that my intent is taking the light that I've shared it with.
Yes, it is.
Thank you
very much, Chad.
Yeah,
appreciate
I'm very appreciative of that. Bruce, to Chad and to Jeff,
right.
I think this, again, is one of those things that really cuts across what's so very vital for
and
all
Fred,
of us, and Fred as well,
Fred,
yeah,
yep.
Is the fact that it's important for us as people who have strong opinions about various things to remember that if Dr. King could sit down with Bull Connor,
yeah,
all right, or he could sit down with the President of the United States,
mm-hmm,
who at some point, I know, he had to be doing some amount of educating,
mm-hmm, yeah,
before he was able to say, I'll do it. We have to do the same thing. I love what Chad just said a moment ago. The fact is, you know, whether it's the Multnomah County Republican Party who did something that really upset somebody, and, you know, again, put Dr. King in a place next to guns or something like that, a man who did give his whole life,
mm-hmm,
for nonviolence, all it takes is, even though it offends us, even though it bothers us deeply, is why can't we find ourselves in the 21st century able to sit down with each other in the very way Dr. King would have? Because
yeah,
the truth of the matter is, that's really how he got a number of things solved. We see the pictures of Dr. King and the protesters of the civil rights movement. But one of the things we know about Kingian nonviolence, mm-hmm, is that long before they protested, they sat down to try to work together. They sat down to try to reason together. And the protests were only because, guess what, all the talking didn't work. And it's really important, I believe, that in Oregon, and I've always considered Oregon one of the best places,
mm-hmm,
even for politics, because I believe that we were not as mean-spirited. I found out differently. But the fact of the matter is, we can solve things here. When we come together and make a decision to want to work together,
mm-hmm,
people of all races and colors can come together on issues and make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And if this is, again, I obviously haven't seen what is being talked
right,
about,
right,
and
right,
it doesn't really matter
but
if I recognize those images are being put together as if it is an endorsement,
mm-hmm,
then it would be speaking in a way that Dr. King's legacy would never have spoken.
Mm-hmm.
But what I believe is that it's important for us to come together as brothers and sisters, and much like Brother Dedman just said,
yes,
it's not tossing anybody out
that's
of the
right,
cart.
That's right.
It's
that's
really
right,
about how do we all come to the table
right,
and reason with one another, recognizing that what has been done is abhorrently offensive,
yes,
but yet let's figure out how we,
yeah,
by the way, get past that, create sensitivity and education for that, and make sure that doesn't happen again. Because what are we teaching our children?
Yeah.
we're teaching our children, I pray the same thing, that if you get in trouble or have difficulty with somebody, even though they're doing things that you don't particularly care for, do not toss them out, do not ridicule them, but try to find a way to love them into understanding where you're coming from and, quite frankly, where they're coming from as well.
Appreciate your response. And I might add to those, it's not just a one-sided situation from the standpoint of Republicans to Chad. From a factual standpoint, it was his former president Reagan basically that signed off on the on that birthday for King.
There's no question.
You know what I'm saying?
And then as a matter of fact, the King family thought that that was one of the ironies of the whole thing. That a Republican president was the one that signed, after all those years of work by Mrs. King, that the King holiday was signed and in effect written by, or rather signed by, President Ronald Reagan.
And then the other situation was a Black History Month.
That's right.
That was signed by another Republican called Gerald Ford.
That's right.
You know
what I mean?
And you just go on down the list. So these were Republicans.
Right.
And I don't want to go back in the history. We're getting from a progressive standpoint. But again, when you start thinking about the March on Washington, if you will, the A. Philip Randolphs were Republicans,
And
the person who put the piece together was Republican. And in fact, it was a Kennedy at the time. It wasn't going to participate.
That's right.
He wasn't participating.
That's right.
He was in it. You know, so this is about Oregon. It's about Americans, if you will.
Yes.
We've got to put this piece together aspect of it and get down to the bottom line. And
well, you know what? Oregon, I mean, if we think about it, Bruce, Oregon has led the nation in understanding the importance of the environment.
Right.
Oregon's led the nation in helping the nation understand about issues of land use.
The bottle bill.
The bottle bill, recycling, just about everything you can think of. The nation is in desperate need right now of showing how we can be civil with one another, how we can be, as another Republican president said, kinder and gentler to each other, work with one another, and really find each other together. I believe we can do that in Oregon.
In Oregon, and take the leadership.
I think we can do it, and I think, quite frankly, we should do it.
Yes.
And I think that we really need, I think America's tired of the mean-spirited politics that we have.
Right.
America's tired of people being ridiculed and literally sized up for the worst mistake they've ever made. And I think people are just saying, if you've got answers, you've got solutions, I want to hear him because I really believe that's really where it's at.
Oh, appreciate that.
Yeah.
And do we have any other calls coming in? And by the way, we still have about 5 minutes or so. And if you're interested in sharing your thoughts and your feeling, regardless of how they are, you know, that's what we're doing. We're filling it out. And we just happen to have the servant from Vancouver Avenue Baptist Church to talk to Oregonians as a whole. Right.
Amen.
OK, fine. I guess we've got a caller on the air. Calling you on the air. Your question or comment, please. OK, we lost that caller. Okay, see if we can get you back on, if you will. But again, we're talking about this time period.
Yes.
You know, we're talking about the month of January and February. It's a huge month. It's America. It's really American history.
It really is.
It's really American history.
Yeah.
And what do you feel about this history being taught in the schools? You know, we had American history at one point in time. And I think back when, again, going back in history and looking at some of the facts, it says Black History Month. Actually, it started back in 1926, if you will, by Carter Woodson. Isn't that something?
Right.
And he had the same concept. He figured that at some short period of time, we wouldn't be worried about it. It would be part of America.
Initially, it was a week.
Wasn't that something?
It was a week, and then it became
a month. Here we are still doing the same thing.
That's right.
Okay,
and our hope really is that one day it will be ingrained in
yes.
American history, because that's really where it belongs.
Yes. We'll begin right here in Oregon, right?
That's right. Again,
Oregonians
here in Oregon.
Can do it. Oregonians can do it.
That's
okay,
right.
Your question or comment, please. We got a caller. Yes, caller.
Bruce, young brother Webb right here.
How you doing, brother Webb? How you doing, sir?
Well, you know, I've been gone for a little while, but not forgotten, evidently. So how are you and your guest?
Good, thank you.
Just fine, brother Webb. Talk to us. What do you think about what we've been talking about?
Oh, Lord, man, these Republicans. I mean, listen, you know, I guess it's just a certain type, you know, but I mean, the time for holding back and being gentle and being kind, that's past us, because, you know, we're out here on the battlefield of ideas and we're trying to move forward, and it feels like people are trying to drag us back, you know. Now, you know, some of your Republican buddies, Bruce, I'll just put it that way, you know, I mean, I myself...
I don't mind. I mean, I don't mind. I'm... I don't problem. No problem. Go on. Keep going. Talk to
me. Okay. You know,
I'm working with him.
You know, so it's about time somebody called out Lars Larson as a racist, and this Jim Villanucci, he's a racist junior. I'm ready to challenge these guys anytime, but they're too cowardly to bring me on their show.
They won't bring,
you know.
Well, you've got them.
I actually wanted to come on to your show with me, and he backed out.
Brother Webb,
these are the people you
hold on for a minute. Hold on, Brother Webb. He's here now with us. You he's going to see this show. What do you say to Lars Larson? Tell him. What do you want to say to him? I got about 2 minutes, by the way. Give me about 1 minute. Go on, talk to him. What do you say to Lars?
I'll say it this way. You know, he thinks he can be cute and say the N-word on his radio station. I heard it. I wrote it down. I wrote down the dates and times. I hear Mother Effer on his radio station. I wrote down the dates and I wrote down the times. Why doesn't he get punished with FCC rules like everybody else? You know, sick of that, and I'm challenging that coward. I challenged him before to come onto your show. He backed out. Now we got this guy before him who's just basically a little sidekick for Lars. I talked to him for about 45 minutes. He didn't even think I was black. He forgot I was black. Why? Because I master the English language at times? You know, it's ridiculous that people are put in a box. He suggested that if I have trouble, I should get a black lawyer. Why can't you find a black attorney? Why, when it becomes the legalities, does it have to be a black attorney for a black man? It's just garbage, Bruce. You know, I've been holding a lot of stuff inside, okay. Bruce, and I've been wanting to get together with you and get back on that show.
Tell you what we'll do. Tell you what you do. Leave your number, and I'm going to get you on the show. Trust me. We got only have but 1 minute. I got to close. I got to let the Reverend close us in for it. Okay? Okay, Brother Webb. Leave that number.
And you bring Jackie Winters on, too.
Okay. Well, leave your number, and we'll get there. Okay. Thanks for the call, Webb. Okay.
Wow.
What do you think, man?
Well, one of the things that I think is important is exactly what you provide for us, and that's a forum for everybody with various thoughts and positions to be able to come and talk about him. But he's absolutely right, whether it's Lars Larson or anybody else.
That's right.
Some things just aren't okay.
Exactly, exactly.
And it shouldn't be tolerated. Okay.
I might add, too, for the viewing audience, too, the Republican Party, all of a sudden, they've identified me. I am the new outreach chair for Multnomah County.
Amen.
And I'm also, from the state standpoint, I'm the engagement chair for the Republican Party. So my point is that work is being done.
I say that they're moving in the right direction.
Yes,
that's all I say. That's good.
You know,
congratulations to you.
Thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you.
And I'm sure Oregonians appreciate you being here and sharing with them what we can do.
Thank you.
Moving forward.
Thank you.
Again, thank you. We appreciate you very, very much. And we hope to see you again to give us another message.
It's a joy.
Okay,
thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay, good to see you. Thank you,
folks.
So much.
Thank you very much for being with us. As usual, we're going to play this show next week also too. So enjoy yourself, and I'll see you week after next. Okay, have a good one.